The definition of dystopia is a community or society that is in some way undesirable. It is the opposite.
Okay, cut, cut, cut. Emotion, people. This is just supposed to be art. God, from the top.
Throughout history, people have dreamed of the ideal society. People laughing, children playing, everyone coexisting in complete harmony. But such a place cannot exist. Even the word utopia, simultaneously meaning good place and no place, contradicts the possibility of the ideal world. Realistic thinking favors the concept of dystopia, a future in which the societal vices we see at work today have overrun all creation. So where did the search for utopia begin? The great philosopher Plato writes of an ideal society in his book, which is titled The Republic. In his interpretation of a utopian society, there are three classes. The highest class consists of the rulers, all of which are philosophers. In the class below, we have the enforcers, who would be our modern-day policemen, and below that is the working class.
Plato understood that his society was not a utopia. If his society was not a utopia, then what was?
By using the idiom, the grass is always greener on the other side, we can better understand Plato's approach to utopia.
Greece was a democracy, and Plato understood that this form of government did not lend itself to being perfect.
Plato thought to himself, if a democracy wasn't perfect, then maybe a republic was. This is the form of government he chose for his perfect society. But was it really perfect?
In order to ensure that people don't question their placement in this society, the rulers in Plato's Republic tell the lower classes that everyone is born with a type of metal in them. The rulers with gold, the enforcers with silver, and the lower class with bronze. Every citizen is tested at a young age to measure their capacity to endure pain and resist temptation. These tests determine which metal they are born with and in which class they are destined to be.
At this point, one can realize that our interpretation of utopia is very different from that of Plato. Utopia is a comparative word. This is basically saying that the utopia of one society could be completely different from that of another. Now, I'm not saying that ancient Greece had lower standards than we do. I'm just saying that as historians, we can't be ethnocentric or judgmental when looking at their society's morals.
Plato has his leaders lying to the general public, and he considers this the ideal form of society. If a leader can only maintain control by lying to the people, then there's undeniably something wrong.
To breed, couples are generated at random by the government. If any children are born without the government's consent, the child is locked in a shed and left to die.
A lack of family structure is a common theme in dystopian societies. This is a direct result of the government wanting complete devotion of the people. Any other conflicting interests would be bad for the whole.
Utopian societies are impossible to achieve, simply because differing environments and morals lead to different views of what a utopia even is. Utopia can never be obtained, because there will always be people like me to nitpick the bad elements out of every utopian proposal out there.
Rome, perhaps one of the greatest societies to exist in our world's history. Some say that ancient Rome defined the success and development of Europe, leading to the expansion of the New World.
The ancient Romans introduced so many ideas into society that it must have been overwhelming. The daily decisions of, should I go to the bath? Should I go to a play? Should I go see the gladiator fights? These rich families introduced many aspects of leisure into society that were scarcely enjoyed by any other than royalty.
The Golden Age of Rome came with great technical advancements, as well as beautiful construction, driving the civilians' desire for personal wealth. While the upper class continued to find new ways to entertain themselves, the government worried about keeping control over the vast lands surrounding the Italian peninsula. In order to keep control, the oppressive government created the gladiator fights. Although this may seem like grand entertainment supporting the Romans' glorious society, things aren't always as they seem.
The stereotypical vision of Rome is a shining city that led to the success of our world today. Some people even go to the point of saying that Rome was almost perfect. This statement is completely false. Most people aren't able to see the underlying corruption of Rome. This golden society that is Rome is defined by the deaths and conquering of other nations. The suffering that Rome caused is justified by their pursuit of utopia. A pursuit of utopia that we ourselves admire today.
The Romans were so incredibly Machiavellian that despite killing thousands, they were able to maintain that glorious image that has lasted through the ages until today. In truth, it's not the government that drives this corrupted vision. It's the self-centered and materialistic upper class that truly drives the dystopian mechanism. They're so entertained by the concept of the annihilation of other human beings that they don't see the truly sadistic nature of their own society.
In a dystopian future, the totalitarian nation of Panem is divided between 12 districts and the capital. Each year, two young representatives from each district are selected by lottery to participate in the Hunger Games. Part entertainment, part brutal retribution of a past rebellion. The televised games are broadcast throughout Panem. The 24 participants are forced to eliminate their competitors, while the citizens of Panem are required to watch, allowing the government to keep a tight grip on Panem's inhabitants.
Oops! You caught me on my coffee break! Anyways, the Hunger Games presents almost an exact parallel to the ancient times gladiator fights. Now, there are three vital pieces to successful gladiator fights that are also seen in the Hunger Games. One, a ruthless, all-powerful government. Two, people being forced to fight to the death. And three, they needed it to be a popular entertainment. Due to the violent tendencies of the upper class and their selfish obsession with material wealth, both Panem and Rome fell in a series of uprisings against their corrupt governments.
Are you not entertained? Are you not entertained? Is this not why you are here?
Flo, I'm scared. I fear my society is falling into dystopia and I'm not prepared. What do I do?
Well, here at Regressive, if you use our simple dystopia plan, you'll be covered for any kind of disaster that comes upon you. Here, in our Regressive Safety Manual, any tip you would ever need to survive an apocalypse is here. Other insurance companies only cover meteor falling on your car insurance and meteor falling on you insurance. But here at Regressive, we cover meteor falling on your car insurance, meteor falling on you insurance, government destroying your house insurance, government destroying your pool insurance, government destroying your yacht insurance, government implosion, terrorist attack, and most importantly, zombie apocalypse insurance. Wow! We sure do have a lot of insurance here at Regressive.
Where can I get all these?
Well, if you call 1-800-APOCALYPSE-PROTECTION in the next 10 minutes will also include epidemic disease insurance. This will help you at any time something comes into your society. Try Progressive, we're impressive. We'll protect you when your society falls.
The Roman Empire fell, and society plunged into a dark abyss. During the Middle Ages, the church was so overpowering and monopolizing over the lives of citizens that people forgot about the Platonic ideal and the goal of a utopian society. Both the church and the feudal system oppressed the people of the Middle Ages. The government idealized efficiency in everything, unfortunately eliminating all aspects of individual creativity. This was a dystopian society. Reformers such as Martin Luther began to speak up about this corrupt society. During the Renaissance, the ideas of Rome and Greece were brought back into society, and the people restored their vision of utopia. New ideas flourished.
In our modern world, one can hardly discuss dystopia without referencing communism. Perhaps this is demonstrative of our ethnocentrism, because communism demonstrates a great many oppositions to our Western ideals, such as the celebration of the individual. The political theory of socialism, which gave rise to communism, had existed for hundreds of years before a German philosopher named Karl Marx wrote his Communist Manifesto in 1848. Marx believed that a truly utopian society must be classless and stateless. To achieve a Marxist utopia, three stages must come to pass.
Phase 1. A revolution must take place in order to overthrow the existing government. Marx emphasized the necessity for total destruction of the existing system. Phase 2. A dictator or elite leader must gain control over the public. During this phase, the new government exerts absolute control over the common citizen's personal choices, including his or her education, religion, employment, and even marriage. Collectivization of property and wealth must also take place. Phase 3. Achievement of Utopia. This phase has never been attained because it requires that all non-communists be destroyed in order for the Communist Party to achieve supreme equality.
An image of dystopian elements can be found in George Orwell's anti-communist satire, Animal Farm. Thus, it is worth knowing that Marx died before any of his theories could be put to the test. Thus, the parallel between Marx and Animal Farm's old major becomes apparent. Both leaders spoke of a golden vision of equality and hoped to eliminate strife between social classes. However, on Manor Farm, the animals suffer from unbearable corruption and dictatorship characterized in most dystopian novels. Mechanisms used by the pigs and the brainwashing methods that they used on other animals are themes commonly used in dystopian literature. In the wake of communism, all that remains is a crippled society with little to no resemblance of the original utopian goal. Thus, communism is a prime example of a utopian attempt that crumbles in the hands of mankind.
In our own society, we see hints of human vices everywhere. Drug dealers and criminals run crime rings in our cities. Major organizations experience corruption. One could characterize our world as dystopian, depending on one's life experiences. While many in our community cannot define our society as such, even from our privileged viewpoint, we can still see the elements of our world that could evolve to extremes that would transform our world into a dystopia.
Human beings have such a fascination with dystopian literature. The authors of these novels write from the viewpoint that they have a much higher knowledge of the future than we do. So under a hood of adventure, young love, and relentless bravery that make up the storylines of these novels in our world,
the authors are subtly warning us of what could become of our society.
And the scariest part is, it's that so many of the flaws in our civilization could easily lead to what these authors write in their novels. And to complicate it more, everyone seems to have a different opinion on what the actual flaws are. Really, who knows? Imagine how our society could change over the course of 100 years.
In a world where all books are burned, Fahrenheit 451 features a dystopian society which destroys all past culture to make way for a fresh one.
In Guy Montag's futuristic America, firemen start fires instead of putting them out. They burn books, which have been tagged as items of destruction by their totalitarian government.
The people do not read, spend time thinking, or enjoy nature.
They have no meaningful relationships, even within families. Forms of entertainment include reckless driving, obsessive devotion to wall-sized televisions, and jamming seashell radio headphones into their ears. Bradbury's work reveals the fears that shape his definition of dystopia. Censorship, ignorance, and dependence on technology govern the world of Fahrenheit 451. While these are indeed factors in modern society, they appear in smaller quantities relative to their beastly power in Fahrenheit 451. In spite of this, these hints are still looked upon as serious threats to the balance of civilization.
This book is just another example of too much government control, and as a result, censorship.
Because it's set in the future, Fahrenheit 451 is a direct reflection of what people fear might happen to our own society. This book contains elements of fear that our society has become far too radical, and that the only thing that the government can do to control it is to censor it, as we see in Fahrenheit 451.
We've seen examples of this in our present-day society with regards to the huge uproar surrounding the SOPA, the bill that could potentially censor the internet. But this is much more prevalent in other countries who have actually taken steps towards censoring material.
George Orwell published his book, 1984, in 1949, hoping to make a statement about the dystopian image in which our society was evolving. Winston Smith lives in London, in the nation of Oceania, in which a group called the Party rules. The Party runs a totalitarian government system in which the government keeps complete control over the people by suppressing individual freedoms. Big Brother is the face of the Party. People know that Big Brother is watching all the time, so they know they must stay in line. The Party controls everything. They plant cameras and microphones into people's homes. They make up a new language, eliminating all rebellious words. And they even rewrite their history to fit their needs. Winston himself works for a segment of the Party called the Ministry of Truth that alters historical records for the convenience of the Party. The Party implements psychological control over their people so that the public automatically believes everything they say. Perhaps most importantly, the Party prohibits free thought and any expression of individuality. So how does this relate to our world today? Today, our agency takes many precautions to ensure a safe and controlled nation. We tap phone calls on a daily basis, track unconfirmed victims, and constantly employ our observational talents to focus on following people of Middle Eastern descent. We turned in a pretty good report in 2008, showing that we only had 800 violations over the past 7 years. In fact, in the next few years, I see our nation advancing in technology so we can continue implementing control in a reasonable fashion. More tapping phone calls, more cracking down on individuality, more control over our society will ensure a more efficient nation. I worked in Burma for 5 years as part of the Indian Imperial Police, but this job was very unsatisfying for me. During this time, I experienced poverty and observed other poor, struggling people in the working class. This sparked my resentment for authority and the imperialistic system I observed. But it wasn't until the Spanish War in 1936 that I knew where I stood. Every piece of literature I wrote after that warned against a totalitarian government, like the one I witnessed in Burma. I write because there is a lie, a mystery that I want to expose, to draw attention to. I write because the people need to be warned of a dire circumstance that could become their future. Dystopia, a society characterized by human misery. Throughout history, the concept of dystopia has evolved, dependent on the societal evils present at any given time. From Plato's distaste for the democracy of ancient Greece to Orwell's experiences with poverty in Burma, an individual's life experiences molds his identity and therefore his views of dystopia. Unifying elements of dystopian theories include oppression, epidemic disease, totalitarian government, and conflicting social classes. However, despite the multiple similarities between dystopian ideas, the proposed solutions to the impending problems are numerous and incredibly diverse. From the seemingly infinite approaches to dystopian literature, one can see how large a fear dystopia has become to the modern individual. In every negative element of society, modern man can see a possible end to civilization. And in every piece of dystopian literature, there lies a warning. Humans must change, and we must change quickly. It will not be easy, but if we stand a chance against the forces of our own evils, if we wish to avoid impending doom, if we seek to dodge the creation of a true dystopia, then we must look back through the past and on into the future in search of a restorative force to guide humanity through the darkest hour and into the light.
I'm waking up to ash and dust. I wipe my brow and I sweat my rust. I'm breathing in the chemicals. I'm breaking in, shaping up, then checking out on the prison bus. This is it, the apocalypse. Whoa, I'm waking up, I feel it in my bones, and I don't make my
possible to achieve simply because of